The storm surrounding the embattled Veterans Administration reached a crescendo today. Heeding a steady drumbeat of criticism and calls for his removal, Eric Shinseki, the 71-year-old retired Army general who had been the president's first and only secretary of the VA, offered his resignation this morning at the White House. Our Jeffrey Brown has the story.
And a few minutes ago, Secretary Shinseki offered me his own resignation. With considerable regret, I accepted.
The announcement came just after Shinseki left his private meeting in the Oval Office, ending his five-year stint in the Veterans Affairs post. President Obama said the secretary decided he could not effectively deal with the scandal in the VA healthcare system amid growing cries for his ouster.
He does not want to be a distraction because his priority is to fix the problem and make sure our vets are getting the care that they need. That was Rick's judgment on behalf of his fellow veterans. And I agree. We don't have time for distractions. We need to fix the problem.
More than 100 members of Congress of both parties had demanded the secretary step down or be fired. In accepting his resignation, the president heaped praise on the retired four-star general.
Rick's commitment to our veterans is unquestioned. His service to our country is exemplary. I am grateful for his service, as are many veterans across the country. He has worked hard to investigate and identify the problems with access to care. But as he told me this morning, the VA needs new leadership to address them.
The storm over Shinseki intensified Wednesday after his own inspector general released a scathing report on the VA Medical Center in Phoenix, Arizona. It found veterans there were waiting an average 115 days to be seen, and 1,700 veterans were kept off any official waiting list. Even more damning, the review said VA staffers in Phoenix cooked the books to make delays appear closer to the goal of 14 days. Today, Shinseki gave the president an internal audit that found similar problems are widespread in the VA healthcare system.
Given the facts I now know, I apologize as the senior leader of the Department of Veterans Affairs.
Before going to the White House, Shinseki offered his own public mea culpa, addressing the National Coalition for Homeless Veterans.
I said when this situation began weeks to months ago that I thought the problem was limited and isolated because I believe that. I no longer believe it. It is systemic. I was too trusting of some, and I accepted as accurate reports that I now know to have been misleading with regard to patient wait times.
He announced the removal of senior VA leaders in Phoenix, and he suspended bonuses for meeting wait time targets. It's been alleged that policy proved an incentive to falsify data.
A business as usual cannot continue.
In Congress, reaction to the resignation poured in from both sides of the aisle. New York Democrat Steve Israel was one of many who said it was the right move.
It is unfortunate that Secretary Shinseki had to resign, although I support that decision. But this does not put a period at the end of the sentence. We owe it to our veterans to get to the root of this problem.
Republicans, led by House Speaker John Boehner, voiced similar sentiments, but in tougher terms.
And until the president outlines a vision and an effective plan for addressing the broad dysfunction at the VA, today's announcement really changes nothing. One personnel change cannot be used as an excuse to paper over a systemic problem.
Major veterans groups also supported the resignation and called for a closer look at the overall VA system. One of the largest, the Veterans of Foreign Wars, said in a statement, "We support Shinseki's decision to resign because the outside calls for his resignation were overshadowing the crisis in health care issues veterans face."
More money.
The president today said he'll leave it to the Justice Department whether the scandal warrants a criminal investigation, as many in Congress are demanding. In the meantime, he's appointed Sloan Gibson, the VA's number two, as acting secretary.
And we explore the problem, the resignation, and what's next with Paul Rieckhoff, an Iraq War veteran and founder and executive director of Iraq and Afghanistan Veterans of America. Joseph Violante is a Vietnam War veteran. He's now National Legislative Director of Disabled American Veterans. And Dr. Stephen Xenakis is a retired Army Brigadier General who had a 28-year career as an Army psychiatrist. He's the founder of the Center for Translational Medicine, a nonprofit organization providing mental health care services to veterans. Welcome to all of you. Paul Rieckhoff, let me start with you. Your reaction to the resignation of Eric Shinseki, was it the right thing to do? Is it best for the VA?
It was, and it needed to happen. Our members across the country had lost confidence in Secretary Shinseki. The country had lost confidence in Secretary Shinseki, and many of the VA employees had as well. So this was a dam that burst. And I think it's important to note, it wasn't just building over the last few weeks. This has been building for years. IG reports have been coming out going back to 2007, noting the wait times. There have been congressional testimonies. Groups like ours have been trying to raise these issues for year after year, and there continue to be delay, stonewalling. And I think that's really part of what got to the bottom of this. Veterans had it. Enough was enough. And we do note that there are much bigger institutional, bureaucratic changes that must take place. This is not going to solve everything. But a change in tone and a change at the top is definitely necessary.
All right. Well, we'll get to those larger issues. But Joseph Violante, your group had not called for the resignation, right? Did you want him to stay on?
That's correct. We supported Secretary Shinseki in the sense that he had brought a lot of change to the VA. We had confidence in his ability to bring change to this once it came to light. So we did not ask for his resignation for those reasons.
And what do you think happened? I mean, why did he decide to do it?
It's a good question. And I think probably because he was becoming a political lightning rod for criticism, and he may have felt that this was bad for the VA.
Now, Stephen Xenakis, of course, the question is, how much does his resignation start to fix the problem, or what's the connection between the resignation and the larger problem?
It could destabilize the problem. What I mean is that it could sort of, for a while, because there's not going to be clear leadership here, and people are going to be spending so much time figuring out who should be the successor and what and discussing the problems, that it could delay there being fixes that he may have already had in place and recognized that he needed to make.
Let me start with you, Stephen Xenakis. What is the problem? Let's go around here. How would you define it?
Well, the started years ago. Mm-hmm. The VA did not prepare for what was going to be now 2.5 million men and women who served in Iraq and Afghanistan. The fact that the population of soldiers and the veterans from the Vietnam War were aging and were going to be hitting a point in time that they're going to need a lot more medical care. And they didn't map out what was going to be the load, the burden, demand for services that were going to be required. They also were an organization that did not welcome change and did not allow themselves, didn't have flexibility in figuring out what they needed to do to meet the mission.
Well, Joseph Violante, Eric Shinseki seemed to go much further, and certainly the IG's report, talking about a systemic, totally unacceptable lack of integrity.
Yes. And I just like to say one thing about this problem, because it started well before these wars. Back in 2001, President Bush established a task force to look at the delivery of health care for veterans. This was prior to the attack on our nation. 2 years later, in May of 2003, the war in Afghanistan was still young. We were just going into Iraq. This task force found that at that time there were 236,000 veterans on a wait list, waiting 6 months or more for care. They also found there was a mismatch between funding and demand. And if that mismatch wasn't addressed, mm-hmm. the situation would impact access. Here we are 11 years later, and that's the problems. We have not addressed those problems then. When that report came out, Congress and the administration shelved it, even though the veterans organizations wanted those recommendations to be looked at.
Well, but those problems, Paul Rieckhoff, come in on this, those problems have been there, you're all saying, for a long time. But this goes further. This is about falsifying reports. And a real lack of integrity was the word used.
Right. It's a total system failure. And it started with the revelations in Phoenix over 4 weeks ago. And the secretary was slow to respond. The president was slow to respond. Now the IG is investigating over 40 different facilities. So it's a system-wide failure. People are cooking the books. And we want to see criminal investigations. I mean, if veterans died waiting for care, then people need to go to jail. I mean, it's really got to be boiled down into human terms here. We've got Iraq and Afghanistan veterans, most in their late 20s, who've served overseas, multiple tours, are coming home and seeking help. They're bravely stepping forward and going to get help, and the VA is failing them. So this is a bureaucratic problem, but it's also been kicked down the road after president and year after year. It's time for the president to step up and make this a presidential priority. He's also got to integrate the other government agencies around the VA and communicate to the American people that the VA can't do it alone. Community-based nonprofits, healthcare groups, veterans groups are also overwhelmed trying to fill the gap, because right now, only about 55% of Iraq and Afghanistan veterans are even using the system. So if we all come forward, the system is going to be stretched that much more. And that's what we expect to happen in the years to come.
Is it, Joseph Violante, is it a funding problem? Is it a congressional oversight problem?
It's both. Mm-hmm. We've asked in the independent budget, which is co-authored by DAV, AMVETS, Paralyzed Veterans of America, and VFW, for $7.8 billion more than Congress has provided for medical care alone over the last 10 years. In construction, that's $9 billion over the last 10 years that VA's been shortchanged. Mm-hmm. So yes, it is, and there needs to be oversight to ensure that VA is spending this money properly. If they're not using it properly to care for veterans, then Congress needs to step in.
Do you think it's a funding issue, Stevens and
I? I don't think it's primarily. I think it's an issue of the culture. You talked about integrity. Mm-hmm. And I think it's people understanding, from the frontline doctors and nurses to the management, of what their responsibility is to the veterans and what they need to do in terms of accomplishing their objectives. I think it's organizational. I think it's how they're set up, mm-hmm. who has what authority to execute programs and develop programs. And I think there's problems with the support systems. The information systems are old and clumsy and clunky. And so I think it's those problems. I would first look at fixing those, bring in the right leadership, and then, because there has been pretty good funding up to now, then think about what the funding needs are going to be.
Mm-hmm. Paul Rieckhoff, what? Speaking of leadership, I mean, what do you? Who do you? Not exactly who, but what kind of person should the president look to now?
Well, we need someone who's aggressive, someone who can be a veterans advocate, not a veterans adversary, someone who can tear through bureaucracy, someone with energy and motivation to really rebrand the VA. This is our opportunity to really change the way the public, our veterans, all of America thinks about the VA. But it's got to be someone who has experience as a turnaround artist.
Well, but is it?
I would argue.
I just want to ask, should it be someone inside who knows the system or outside who can come in and totally change the system?
Well, I think it's clearly got to be somebody from the outside. I mean, the calcified bureaucracy internally is part of what Secretary Shinseki wrestled with throughout his term. And again, we just need a system that works. It shouldn't be that complicated to have a disability claim, for example, go through a process. But our veterans are routinely waiting 6 months, sometimes years, because until recently, it was a paper-based system. This is a system that has to be dragged forward into the 21st century. It has to be a system that emphasizes technology, responsiveness, and most of all, I think, especially right now, transparency. So there's got to be someone who can do a thorough house cleaning and restore that confidence at every level.
Joseph Violante, insider or outsider, what's the best way forward?
I don't know that it makes a difference, but it has to be someone who is willing to come in and look at the entire structure, listen to the veterans that have been working with the VA for all these years, and determine what needs to be done in having the authority from the president to do its
necessary. And very briefly, Stephen Xenakis, you're the one who talked about the culture. So is it the leadership or just?
It's a leadership. I think you've got to bring a turnaround artist, a person who knows how to change organizations. I think he's got to be from the healthcare field and understand how complex that is. And he's got to be bold, but I think he's got to come from the outside and be able to put a fresh eye on it.
All right. Stephen Xenakis, Joseph Violante, Paul Rieckhoff, thank you all three very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.